it's a great pleasure to be here and to be in Pechen. I'm particularly glad that I have chosen some very beautiful weather here so that I can enjoy also the sightseeing a bit of your beautiful town. The title of my talk today is The Actuarial Profession in a Changing Risk Landscape, Some Challenges. And to make sure that we all know the word actuarial, this is the world of insurance. So an actuary is like an insurance mathematician, is a mathematics or an economics or a quantitative person working in an insurance company. And so my talk will very much be on aspects of this particular profession, which is, you could say, is a part of economics. I don't see it as a part because I think it's extremely important, totally independent of economics. So that's the title of my talk. Now, as you already said, Georgie, I'm from ETH Zurich. So this is ETH Zurich. If ever you come to Zurich, in the center of the town, that building here with the round cupola here, that's the ETH. The big tower behind it, that's the University of Zurich. And ETH was founded much, much later than your university here, about 500 years later, I think, in the 1850s, but I think it's a very well-known university. For instance, we have had about 21 Nobel Prizes also at ETH already. Now, whenever I give a talk, I want to ask questions to the audience. And I normally say I will ask questions to the people sitting in the back, but I will not do it today. So I will ask questions. Only one of them, I think. Well, perhaps we'll see. Who knows these two students? These were former students of ETH. Let's start with the left student. That student everybody knows. Yes? Einstein, Albert Einstein. He was a student at ETH Zurich, and of course he did his fundamental work at ETH. Who is the second student? You cannot answer, you know. Who is the second student on the right? Yeah? No? He's Hungarian. Von Neumann. No, no, not Erdős. Oh, by the way, as a little joke, I got Erdős number one. Not in publications. I played table tennis with Paul Erdős. And I think there are very few people in this audience who had played table tennis with Paul Erdős. I did. Sorry? No, this is John von Neumann. So von Neumann. Of course, he's Hungarian. He was a student in chemistry, chemical engineering, at ETH. There are many more important students, but at least I wanted to start with these two, I think, very famous. I want to already, for the students, this is not a technical talk. This is not a talk on mathematics. If you're interested in mathematics, you can read some of the books I wrote, Modeling of Extremal Events or Quantitative Risk Management. They're both very thick, 600-700 pages. Okay, but you can read them if you like. Or you can go to my website. On my website, you find many, many, many papers. All the recent research, you can always find on my website. By the way, let me make a little joke about the book on the left. There was a famous probabilist in Princeton. I will not mention his name, but he said, it's a very nice book, he said. The only problem is there are too many pages between the first and the last. So, but I think they're both very good books. So I will now talk about the main part of my talk, actuaries. And as you see on the bottom right, there's a Hungarian actuarial society, a society that brings together young people and professionals in the field of insurance. And I will talk to you about the actuary of the nth type or the nth kind. And this started with N equals 3, actuaries of the third kind, by my colleague Hans Bühlmann, who is the older gentleman to the right. He's now almost 90. He's doing fine. I was a successor of Professor Bühlmann in 1989 when I moved to ETH. And he wrote a very important editorial where he said actuaries, insurance mathematicians in companies, have always or very much concentrated on the liabilities, on the losses. but have not concentrated too much on the assets, the investment. And he said that in 89 is extremely important that actually start to do asset liability thinking, i.e. have the two sides of the trading, of the book, of your business book, the assets as well as the liabilities. And he said that's very important for actuaries to do. And he called them the actuaries of the third kind. It was a bit of a joke in the title, but let me see what where I think you could look at that particular third kind. What would I call an actuary of the first kind? An actuary of somebody, an expert in insurance of the first kind, we go back to the 17th, 18th century. Let's say the life insurance actuary. I mean, demographic life data are, I'm not saying they're deterministic, but they're close to deterministic. We don't really very deep stochastic models to model the number of people born in a country or the age distribution. So that's actually of the first kind. Actually of the second kind, now we turn to the 20th century. The beginning of the 20th century, cars came on the road. People started to have property, housing, money. So now the the whole business became much more stochastic, randomness. You drive a car and you may have an accident. That's a random event. The law of large numbers enters in writing, in getting premium for insurance. But it was very much based stochastics. And then, of course, came the actuary of the third kind. I already mentioned the fourth kind, which I somehow started a little bit. This is called the Enterprise Risk Management Actuary, ERM. So this is really an actuary or an insurance mathematician or an economist working in insurance that really gets more involved with company-wide risk management. It's not just assessing the liability, assessing the assets, linking them up. It's a global risk management setup, very much driven by the regulators. Okay, so that's important. So these are this one, two, three. I will finish my talk. I think the last slide, the one but last slide, will be the actuary of the fifth kind, which I think is by far the most important. But let's see when we get there. Now, the title of my talk was Actuarial Professions on Challenges. I will just read this together with you. And I will say something, by the way, I leave my slides here. If the students want to see the slides, they can find them somewhere on a repository. On the red things, I say, I will say a little bit more, but I've got time constraints. Well, what are challenges in every country all over the world, certainly also in Hungary, of insurance, insurability? Well, let's just start and let's see, is it an easy world or a complicated world? Low negative interest rates. And think of life insurance. Guarantees. Demographic changes, the inverted people pyramid. Now more and more older people for supporting young people. Inverted population, conflicts, political conflicts, social and technological networks. I will say a bit more about that. They play an extremely important role in insurance, finance, economics. Environmental risks, catastrophes, business interruption, just-in-time production. The data deluge, big data, data science, you know these words. I think a nice summary one of my colleagues once said, Peter Bühlmann, he said, it rains data now. Now you have to take an umbrella, not to cover the rain, but you have to take an umbrella to cover the data falling on your head. Machine learning, as a consequence, machine learning, neural networks, artificial intelligence, it's everywhere. All the students will, whatever you do, you'll be involved with that. Even those studying linguistics. Automatic translation, for instance. Automatic poetry writing. That's not my topic. Information technology-driven products, self-driving cars, drones, robots. And of course, with all these items, you have to think there is an insurance component there. Think just of a drone falling on your head or the drone loses a package. Blockchain-driven technology, cryptocurrencies. I mean, for the economic students, the whole area of cryptocurrency is important. By now, there are more than 700 cryptocurrencies. Many of them die within one day, but they're there for some reason, good or bad. Alternative risk transfer, transfer of risk between the insurance market and the financial market. Insurance-linked securities, where the payout of your insurance or of your investment is an insurance event-driven one. And then, of course, there are these intersections with modern technology, and these words are standard words, insurtech, fintech, and regtech. It sounds more like a when you go out for dancing, I think, in the weekend, but it's sort of like a reggae thing, but it's insurance-related technology, finance-related technology, and regulation in the new developing technological world. And this is not a complete list, but I think I hope that you realize that this world we now live in from that point of view, is a very challenging world. Every single bullet point here has enormous insurance-related, society-related consequences. And I think I'm very glad to see many students here, because it's your task to solve some of these problems. So now I will go a bit through the red list. So let me start with technological and social networks. And there's a link to Hungary here. Let me start in the middle. There's a famous statement by Stanley Milgram, 1967, 6 degrees of separation. Don't read the rest yet, just concentrate on that middle line. That means that if I take two people, basically at random, by measure of acquaintance, I know you, I've spoken to you, I spoke to you about my watch, there's an acquaintance. So that's one line of separation. Now, we can achieve any two people in the world, basically, with less than 6 steps. For instance, how do I get from me to Mr. Trump? Well, I know Robert Engel personally. He's a Nobel Prize in economics. He won his Nobel Prize. He was invited at the White House where he met President Obama. That's 2. And President Obama knows President Trump. So 3. So in 3 links, I'm with Mr. Obama. So in 4 links, you're with Mr. Trump. In 4 links, you're Mr. Trump. It's amazing. It's really amazing. Now, this, very few people know this, and I will pronounce it wrongly. I'm not sure what the student is, but she taught me how to pronounce. From Phryges Corinthes Lanchimek, roughly. Chain links. This was written in 1929, and this is now translated, not by me, from the Hungarian. Planet Earth, 1929, has never been as tiny as it is now. Using no more than 5 individuals, in that kind of 5, one of whom is a personal acquaintance, he could contact a selected individual using nothing except a network of personal acquaintances. So it goes back to an Hungarian writer that all of you know, I think. If you look at Facebook, the link, this is much more difficult to calculate. On Facebook, the link was 474 in 2011, now it's 3.57. This is frightening. This is really frightening. That's 3 to 4. Everybody on Facebook is linked with everybody else on Facebook. I think this is really frightening. This gets to networks, systemic risk, domino effects. Well, where did it start? Like so much in mathematics with Leonhard Euler. This is just a little aside. Most of you know the famous problem of Königsberg, where the problem was in Königsberg, you had the river Pregel, and you had 7 bridges crossing the river Pregel. And there was an old exercise, the yellow bridges. Can you walk through Königsberg, crossing all the bridges, but crossing the bridges, all of them, but only once? Now you can start and you can try to see whether you can do it, and well, Euler solved it, and I will only do a very quick do. How did Euler do that? He made a wonderful mathematical abstraction, and this is what mathematicians are good at. I said, it's not important that we see houses and trees there, let's This is Königsberg. Okay, that's Königsberg. It's just the same. And now, why do we have to have that middle island big? I can make it a point. So all the green are reduced to a point. And from that point goes a bridge. That's the same picture. So this is Königsberg with the bridges. And now the problem is solved. Because you can start at the bridge, you can end at the bridge. These are the only bridges where you can have an odd number of bridges coming. You start, you walk, you come back, you must leave. So these are the only ones, the beginning and the end. But you see, all the land points have odd number of bridges arriving there. Problem solved. There is no such way in Königsberg. Now the point is, this is the start of a completely new, I would even say it, Hungarian field of mathematics. Graph theory, combinatorics is very much related to that. And of course, the world is full of graphs. This is one of my colleagues in economics, Frank Schweitzer. They have this complicated setup of links between banks worldwide. Of course, one has to define what do these links mean, etc. But there's in the whole area of network vulnerability, the bottom line here, graphical methods started by Euler, but now become a field on its own, have become extremely important. Okay, so you can ask questions. If I join two of these banks, what does that mean for the strength or the weakness of the system? So there's a lot of interesting work in economics now in this particular area. So networks, interdependence are extremely important. And this is just a little statement I make. The second thing, challenges. Environmental risk catastrophes, business interruption insurance. Now I come a bit closer to my own work. This is the barometer of the Allianz. Allianz is one of the big insurance companies in the world. And every year they give a list of the insurance threats to the insurance industry. And you see number one and two. Number one is business interruption. Now, business interruption is when something happens. It can be a cyber risk. It can be a storm that hits the company or, I mean, let's say, the computer center. You interrupt the business. That's still, I don't want to read the rest of the slide, but that's a very important area of insurability. And it's increasingly important also because of just-in-time production and the whole existence of networks. So that's a very important area. And I'll give you one example. I mentioned number four, also natural catastrophes here. I'll give you an example of one and four together. And this is the Thai flood in 2011. And I still remember because at that time I was flying over Thailand on my way to Chiang Mai. And I saw that picture on the left on top in Thailand. And now what was the process? Let's look at some of the numbers. This was due to rainfall in the upper area, on the bottom right, in the upper area of the Chao Phraya River in Thailand. There was a lot of rain coming. It flooded the downside area around Bangkok. It flooded in this way, as you see in the picture. One important aspect was that it holds a lot of manufacturing industry. You see the top right, the one but last bullet point. For instance, in that area, a very high proportion of the world's components of hard disks were manufactured. That made the price of a hard disk overnight twice as expensive. The area was flooded for 156 days, I think, something like that. 158 days. That's business interruption. And of course, with just-in-time production, our world is so much dependent on this type of constructions. And I think this was a big eye-opener. You can look, I will not look at the other numbers, but believe me, this is one of, we all know Katrina and all these storms. That's one of the worst insurance events that happened so far. But this is an example of a business interruption case. I can give you many more examples. Machine learning, neural networks, artificial intelligence. I will say very little. It's not my area of research. My colleague works it. I just want to drop some words. Whoever you are, whatever you're going to work in, you will not be able to move away. Even if you open your refrigerator in 10 years, some machine learning, artificial intelligence will be working. And so in insurance, it's becoming a big area. And for instance, one of my colleagues in Risk Club, Mario Wittrich, is an expert. I will not explain this picture. I don't have the time for that. But this is a picture of three different car drivers. And it's a sort of velocity acceleration diagram, velocity acceleration. And you are able to, with continuous monitoring in your car, you're able to map the driver's style of each individual driver in some of these VA maps. And for instance, just one detail I show you, if you look at the the middle driver, yes, you see that the green part and the yellow part is a bit more broad. That person accelerates much more and brakes more. So you can really, looking at these pictures, get a lot of interesting characteristics for each single driver. This is very different from classical insurance. Classical insurance is Jacob Bernoulli, is the law of large numbers. We're now moving away, not away from that, but we now are finding techniques that allow us to look at individual behavior. I can live with that perhaps at the level of car insurance. I've got a serious problem if we go to the level of health insurance, but it's happening. I don't know how many, it will not ask the question, I don't know how many of you have one of these health maps that start trembling when your heartbeat is not going well. There's so many of them now. In 10 years, the whole audience will have these things on their arms or somewhere. So you can look at, if you're interested in this area, you can look at Mario Wittrich's homepage and you'll find things like data analytics for non-life insurance, convolution neural network classification of telematics car driving. I mean, 5 years ago, nobody would understand these sentences. It's there now, and companies are extremely interested. And then embedding classical actuarial models and neural networks, or so these are new, I'm just saying these are new paradigms in the insurance world. These are just some research papers of Mario Wittrich. I would just want you to drop the names. Any educational program in economics, well, I'd say now you talk about, I think business analytics is the big word in your world, I think, or in insurance education, you cannot avoid learning about this. And I'm not a neural network person, but I can tell you, I'm excited to see what Mario and many of his colleagues, not many, several colleagues worldwide are achieving. It's highly interesting. Next example. Blockchain-driven technology. Well, you all know blockchain is the computer system underlying the computer technology underlying, let's say, cryptocurrencies. The big word that I want to just get into your mind is smart contracts. That means we have a contract buying, selling a house. We don't go to a notary, but there is a blockchain cover of our contract that arrange our solution of the buying and selling of a house. Again, this is there today. Where does it enter insurance? Again, don't look in detail. I just give you an example of a company. This is the company B3i. And you see the company B3i, very much linked to Swiss Re, big reinsurance company in Zurich. And these are all the other companies involved. They're insurers, they're brokers, they're reinsurers. All of them work together. And B3i as a company is a blockchain insurance industry initiative aiming at improving efficiency across the re and insurance world. And it serves, there's something called the distributed ledger. A ledger is in the old day, if you go back to the Pisa, and not just look at the tower. Next time you go to Pisa, walk behind the tower, and then look at some of the famous people who are buried there. And in those areas, a lot of the in Italy in those days, a lot of the development of double bookkeeping, like Fra Luca Pacioli in Perugia. I mean, that's a ledger. How do you put your economic data onto a piece of paper? Asset, liability, active, passive. And they have to match. Well, that's a ledger. Now, this the main thing of this solution now is, if you look at the basics of insurance reinsurance, I just briefly mentioned it, there are typically three players. The first player is the classical reinsurers. You want to insure a catastrophic risk, you go to a reinsurer, that's a second company, and then the reinsurer does some, that's called retrocession. The reinsurer reinsures some of its risk. That's a typical reinsurance construction, extremely important in the world of economics and finance. Now, each of them have their own ledger, their own book, where they keep everything together. Now, with blockchain technology, you can reduce that to one ledger, one book. Of course, there's technology behind, but that's the big save. It's happening, it's there. I've seen wonderful examples. It's there. Also, real-time follow-up of major claims. So I just mentioned that for the moment. Alternative risk transfer, I think that's the last example. Insurance-linked securities. Here are just examples. Now, I wish I had a bit more time because I really could now go into detail. There's this enormous market, let's call it Wall Street. And there's this insurance market. The stock market is so enormously voluminous that, of course, they are looking, and now I'm getting close to my paper that you mentioned, to what they call beta zero products. You want to have independent investments, non-correlated, but I will not go into detail here. That's what they're looking for. Now, here is the insurance world. So in the first instance, the price of IBM is presumably not linked to the price of the value of my life insurance. So there's a kind of a detachment of these two. So can I perhaps do as an extra investment in the banking world, look at insurance-linked security, a security that's triggered by an insurance event? And here are examples. Well, there's a first of all, and I did some quite a bit of work on that. The first one was in 1992, the Chicago Board of Trade, CBOT, catastrophe futures. So we had housing insurance in the US. They were then securitized and sold onto the financial world. An early example was the Winterthur Insurance Hail Bond. I was also very much involved in that with my colleagues. Just give you one example. What's a hail bond? You know hail, it's these pieces of ice falling out of the sky, like occasionally like bigger tennis balls. A hail bond is the following. I sell you a bond. It's a Winterthur Insurance, the insurance company. It's a bond, and let's say the bond has, let's say, 1 year. It's not exactly like that. Let's say a 4% coupon. If nothing specially happens, I, Winterthur, pay you 4% by the end of the year. Okay, that's good. Especially, it will be very good now. Now, I make it a hail bond. Now, I say this payment is now contingent on, is depending on a catastrophic event. If, and now it's insurance, if during one event, hail storm event, more than 2,000 cars of Winterthur insurance car coverage are hit by the hail, losses by hail, then I pay her not 4%, perhaps 2%. You see, the payout on your bond is less. It may even reduce the nominal. And there is, for instance, an example. Well, there are many examples here. Crop insurance, catastrophe insurance, pandemic bonds. There is something called the World Bank Ebola Bond. That would be a very interesting discussion with pros and cons, but that the you want to make sure that money flows quickly. Let's now in Zaire, where there's a crisis of Ebola, it's now triggered by more or less cases of Ebola. If we have, I think it was around more than 200 cases, then again the bond which was given out will be triggered. But it has to have at least two countries. Okay, that's a definition. You can discuss that. I don't want to go into that. But there are now many bonds that are triggered by insurable events, by catastrophic events. I was recently asked, an English company called me on aqua insurance. This was in Indonesia. Shrimp insurance. There were big shrimp farms. And of course, they are very liable to weather loss. Now you can say, well, the company or the state gives out bonds. The payment of the bond depends on the loss on shrimps. Now, of course, I don't think we will start, a storm comes, I don't think anybody wants to start counting the number of shrimps that we have lost. That would be impossible. That's why many of these bonds are parametric. You look out there, you see there's a loss of shrimps in a storm. Well, the loss of shrimps must be somehow proportional to the intensity of a storm in the area. A bigger storm, more losser, a smaller. So let's make it a trigger be the storm. Now that's also very good, because as people say, a storm is like an act of God. I cannot influence the storm. I can influence the loss of shrimps, but not the storm intensity. And so that's the kind of products, an extremely interesting area, how to model these things. I've got many more examples, but this year's, why is, for the students in economics, why is Mr. Nordhaus important? You see this name there? Nordhaus. What happened to Mr. Nordhaus last year? Nobel Prize. He got the Nobel Prize for environmental notes. The same thing. You you make sort of bonds that are a function of the CO2 emissions or so, and so there's a whole market trading now. And of course, many of these things link up with insurance. So what we could now, but that would be a whole couple of hours discussion, so it's, there are many of them. Why are they there now? I already mentioned, it's an alternative investment. Some of them I can discuss on ethical grounds, perhaps, like the Ebola bond. But I think I would not go too quickly along that road. We should discuss it. How can we do it? I gave you the example of a parametric solution to the shrimp farm. Rather than counting the shrimps, I measure the intensity of the storm near the shrimp farm. And when? So when is, why is it that now there are exactly now more of these? Well, this is because it's also related to the way the stock markets go. So it's, these things are very much related. So that's why I keep on saying it's extremely important also for your university to have a little group that's interested in the insurance side. You cannot decouple insurance from finance and economics. It's so important. And I often say for Switzerland, but I think it's true for Hungary, in Switzerland we have three important problems. Social insurance, health, pensions, invalidity, social insurance, and social insurance. I could give you a fourth one if you like, but you can guess. It's for all of you. The intergeneration gap. You young people pay for me, I'm now retired, I'm emeritus. You pay part of my pension. I think we should be thinking about that. Is that, are these systems good or not? These are the important aspects of our society. And many of these things happen in that. So where does it leave? This is the one but last slide. I'm sure your watch is okay. I think it's, I should be all right, I think. Okay? So where does that leave? So I mentioned challenges, actuarial profession. I just gave you a little, in French you say, un tour d'horizon. I just walked around this area without going into detail. So where does that leave actuarial education and research? going forward. I think all of the problems I showed you are extremely interesting applied research problems. It's full of them, even purely mathematical. I mean, I'm still a pure mathematician from time to time, so there's still pure mathematics there. So here comes my, if there's one thing you should learn by heart, is say the Paul Embrace definition of the actuary of the fifth kind. What is for me an actuary? An actuary, and every word is important in this definition, is data-driven, you cannot do differently, model-guided. I think that's exactly, that's why you're, many of you are mathematicians, statisticians, economists. We need quantitative models. So it's data-driven, model-guided, critical. I hope actuaries are critical and extremely important, socially responsible. That's exactly what you as an actuary stand for. As an actuary, when you do the reserving in your company, you want to make sure that if there's a problem with your company, that the reserves are there to pay for the liabilities of your customers. It's not like in the banking world. Also, you have to be socially responsible there. But in the actuarial world, it's extremely important. In an ever-changing world, which is governed by uncertainty. So again, these words are all different. Data-driven, model-guided. You have to be a critical personality. You have to be absolutely socially responsible. These are it's difficult to teach, but I can at least hope as professor contribute to that, behaving like that. The world is changing. You saw the whole list of changes. And I can give you more, but I think I gave you some of the most important. And one thing is for sure, all of these problems, there's a highly important component of randomness, uncertainty. And I think adaption, I've got this statement of Stephen Hawking on intelligence, is the ability to adapt to change. So with this, I think I'll stop my talk. Thank you. Thank you.